Welcome to Engineering Python. This is a Python programming course for engineers. In this video, I will talk about NumPy array indexing and slicing. We'll start with 1D array indexing and slicing. First, we need to import NumPy as np. Let's create a 1D array A. It contains a squared value of the integer numbers from 0 to 4. If we want to access a second number in this array, we use a followed by a pair of brackets, then a number 2 inside the brackets. Note in Python, indexes start from 0, so the element with an index 2 is 4. If we want to access several elements in sequence, we can use a slicing like this. A followed by a pair of brackets, and then from 2 to 5, including 2, but not including 5. So the result is 4, 9, and 16. In this example, because we didn't specify the start point, by default, it starts from index 0. This 4 means we go up to index 4, but not including 4. This 2 means a step of 2. So we select every other element. Let's count, select 0, skip 1, select 2, skip 3, not including 4. So the result is just the elements in locations 0 and 2. They are 0 and 4. We can also change some elements in an array. In this example, the numbers 0 and 4 will be replaced by negative 100. If we want to put the array in reverse order, we can use this expression. No start, no end, the step is negative 1. This is the result. This operation is not done in place, so A doesn't change afterwards. Now let's talk about 2D array indexing. We create a 2x3 2D array A using the reshape function. This is the 0th row. This is the 1st row. To access the 1st row, we use A followed by a pair of brackets and a number 1 inside the brackets. This is the 1st row, which is a 1D array. To access the element at the cross of the 1st row and the 1st column, we further append another index 1 inside a pair of brackets like this. The element at the intersection of the 1st row and the 1st column is 4. A more common way to access a single element is to put the row index and the column index in the same pair of brackets, separated by a comma, like this. The result is 4. Let's compare 2D array indexing with the indexing of a list of lists. B is a list of two lists. B1 means the first element. It's a sublist. B11 will access the first element in this sublist. The number is 4. However, this representation, B1,1, will not work for lists. If you run this, it will create an error. Now let's create another larger 2D array using array reshaping. It is a 5-row by 5-column array. We will use this array to demonstrate 2D array slicing. In the following examples, we should remember that Python indexes always start from 0. In this statement, we will access the elements that are in the 1st row and the 2nd and 3rd columns. In this image, these elements are marked by red cells. There are two numbers, 7 and 8. This statement will access the elements starting from the 3rd row, going up to the end row, and starting from the 3rd column, going up to the end column. These four elements are marked by green cells. This statement will access the elements in all the rows and the 1st column. These five elements are marked by purple cells. The result is a 1D row array, because we already talked about this in the previous video, NumPy doesn't differentiate between 1D row arrays and 1D column arrays. In this statement, because we didn't specify the start and the end for rows, but we did specify the step, which is 2, we will select the 0th row, the 2nd row, and the 4th row. We will also select the 2nd column, the 4th column, and the resultant cells are marked in yellow. There is another type of indexing for NumPy arrays. They are called advanced indexing or fancy indexing. Basically, we access the elements in one NumPy array using another NumPy array as the index. Let's create a 1D NumPy array, A, with 5 elements. This is the data array. Then we create another 1D array, I, with 4 elements. This is the index array. We access them in this format. So the data will come from the data array, and the indexes will come from the index array. That means, when we select the 3rd element, which is 9, the 1st element, which is 1, the 3rd element, which is 9 again, and the 0th element, which is 0. The resultant array always has the same shape as the index array. In this case, it always has 4 elements. Fancy indexing can also be applied to 2D index arrays. This A is still a 1D data array with 5 elements. We create an index array J, which is a 2x2 array. If we assemble them in this way, we are accessing the 0th element in A, which is 0, the 3rd element, which is 9, the 2nd element, which is 4, and the 4th element, which is 1. Again, the elements in the resultant array come from the data array, and the shape is determined by the index array. So it's a 2x2 2D array. For fancy indexing, both the data array and the index arrays can be 2D arrays. Here is an example. C is a 3x4 2D data array. I is a 2x2 2D index array for the row indexes. J is a 2x2 2D index array for the column indexes. If we assemble them in this way, we are selecting the elements in the 2nd column. The row information is determined by the index array I. This element will be 0th row and 2nd column. This will be 1st row and 2nd column, 1st row and 2nd column, and the last one will be 2nd row, 2nd column. The result is a 2x2 array. Similarly, if we assemble them in this way, the row information is determined by the index array I, and the column information is determined by the index array J. The result is another 2x2 array. We can also change the values of these elements in the data array C to negative 1. So these values in the corresponding locations are updated as a result. Boolean arrays can also be used as indexes for fancy indexing. Let's see some examples. We create a data array A. It's a 3x3 2D array. We create another array B by comparing A with 4. This is an element-wise comparison, so the result is another Boolean array with true or false values. This is our index array. We assemble them in this way. The result is a 1D array. The shape is not the same as the index array anymore. These elements are those in A and greater than 4. We can assign a new value, negative 1, to these locations, so the data array is changed to this. The last 4 numbers are replaced by negative 1. We further define a Boolean array, I. It will serve as the index array for the row indexes. Another Boolean array, J. It will serve the index array for the column indexes. In this statement, the row information will come from I, and we will consider all the columns. The result is the 1st and 2nd rows of the data array because only these indexes are true. In this statement, the column information will come from J, and we will consider all the rows. The result is the 0th and 2nd columns of the data array because only these indexes are true. I need to add a little bit more about fancy indexing. Let's create a 5x5 array like this one. I represent this array in this image. Suppose we want to access the elements in the red cells in the diagonal line. We can find their indexes and put them in two tuples. This one is 0 and 0, so 0 and 0. This one is 2 and 2, so 2 and 2. This one is 4 and 4, so 4 and 4. The resultant array is just the one we wanted. If we want to access the green cells, these 2 and these 4, we can do it in this way. These elements are located in the 1st, 3rd, and 4th row. So we have a list with 1, 3, and 4. They are the row information. These elements are located in the 3rd and last columns. So this starts from 3. Go to the end column. This array is what we wanted. If we want to access the purple cells, we can use a boolean mark like this. The data type is bool. We only want the 3 middle elements. So their values are 1s and the other 2 on the sides are 0s. This is the boolean array we created. These elements are located on the first row, so the row index is 1. The column information is supplied by this mask. This is the result array. It is what we wanted. Lastly, if you want to access the yellow cells, we can use a more advanced concept called the index mesh. We create an index mesh using the ix underscore function. The first argument is the row information. Because the yellow cells are located in the first and fourth rows, the second argument is the column information. Because the columns are not continuous, we use the r underscore operator to stack them together in a row. This is the created index mesh. We can use this mesh directly as the index of the data array. The result is just what we wanted. At the end of this video, I will talk about array stacking and splitting. We create a 2x2 2D array A, which contains 0 and positive numbers. We also create another 2x2 2D array B, which contains 0 and negative numbers. The vstack function will merge these two arrays vertically, A on top of B. Note that this argument is a list. A tuple also works. However, this doesn't work because it's two arguments and not a tuple. This hstack function will merge these two arrays horizontally, A in front of B. Note that this argument is a tuple. A list also works. Array splitting is a reversed operation compared to stacking. We create a 3x3 array and use it to demonstrate the splitting. The vsplit function passes two parameters, the array A and how many parts it will be split into. In this case, it's 3. This array will be split vertically into 3 parts. The result is 3 rows. The hSplit function also passes 2 arguments, the array A and how many parts it will be split into. It's also 3. This array will be split horizontally into 3 parts. The result is 3 columns. Okay, that was all about NumPy array indexing and slicing. The course materials are available on YouTube and GitHub. You can watch the course videos in sequence. If you like this video, please subscribe and share. I'm Yong Wang. Thanks for watching.